Thank you very much for the presentation. My name is Yeying Li. I'm a PhD student in Leiden University in the Netherlands. And I'm very interested in the presentation. I have kind of two questions in mind. And one is about the OMT program you just described. And sounds like something like the Greek drama thing that you could actually work to some short period. But I wonder what happens if it actually fails. And can you, what would be the possibility for restructuring back then? And one reason for this question is because seems like the ECB has promised they would be ready to get equal treatment with the private creditors. So in a way that I would imagine when the restructuring comes in the coming years, it's very difficult either to reprofile or to have a haircut, since the ECB, I imagine they wouldn't even expect those kind of things. And the other question is about the IMF adjustment program. I'm very curious of why that this is actually linked to the OMT program, because in a way that for IMF to have its adjustment program, one rationale was that the IMF member states wants to make sure that the money they lend would be paid back. Then why it has to do with the ECB's program, and why not let countries to adopt their voluntary adjustment program, which I think may be better to help them regain competitiveness. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Three excellent questions. Let me take them in the order. What happens if OMT fails? Here's my assessment. Look at my five options. If market access cannot be preserved through the OMT program, then you're down to my last three options: a full bailout, a reprofiling, or a full-scale restructuring. A full bailout, hard to see that the official sector will do that again. First, for countries like Spain and Italy, the amounts are colossal. So you would be talking about lending. I think Italy alone has 415 billion euros of debt maturing in the next 15 months alone. So an idea that they would lend the country that amount of money to repay its existing creditors, put aside the political consequences of that in Northern Europe, that's an awful lot of money. It would outstrip their existing bailout mechanism. So that may be off the table. The last option, a Greek-style restructuring, is in my view also off the table. Why? Because unlike Greece, in Italy and Spain, the foreign investors have largely fled. Greece had two-thirds of its investor universe as foreigners when it did its restructuring. The Spanish and the Italians, too much time has gone on, and the foreigners have fled and been displaced by local financial institutions. If you were to say, inflict a 53% haircut and a 79% net present value haircut on that investor group, they are local financial institutions, banks, pension funds, insurance companies, you would decapitate your own financial institution. Therefore, as Sherlock Holmes might have said, exclude the impossible, and whatever is left, however improbable, must be true. That leads you to a reprofiling. A reprofiling, remember now the country has lost market access, OMT, your hypothesis has failed. The official sector, I don't think, will lend the money to repay maturing debt. The other solution is kick it out of the program period, reprofile the debt, mandatorily extend them, use your local law power to do that, kick them down the road, and you will not have to borrow from the official sector during that program period nearly as much money as you might otherwise have had to do if you were pursuing a full gross bailout. Moreover, you can say to your local investors, you folks were going to roll over your exposure anyway. Look at Italy. As far as I can tell, Italian financial institutions have been prepared, decade after decade, to roll over their exposure to Italian government bonds since Hadrian died. So this would simply be to say to the Italian institutional investor community, you folks were going to do this anyway, we just made it mandatory. And the beauty of a reprofiling is the net present value loss is relatively small. In Uruguay's case, with a 5-year stretch out, I think it was 19%. It is tolerable. And therefore, my guess, exclude the impossible, whatever is left, however improbable, must be true, that leads you to option 4, a reprofiling. Your second question is fascinating. When Mr. Draghi announced the OMT program, he said that the European Central Bank would, in the event of a future restructuring, accept a treatment that was equal. He used the Latin phrase pari passu, in equal step, with the private creditors, something they were not, I repeat, not prepared to do with the bonds they bought from Greece. They had bought 40 to 50 billion of Greek bonds, and they adamantly refused to participate in the debt restructuring earlier this year. But he said, we're going to change that policy. Subsequent to that statement, which was on September 6th, both Draghi and the German representative on the governing council, Jörg Asmussen, have said something flatly inconsistent. They both have said that the ECB's charter forbids it from financing a member country. And to restructure, even for one day, a debt instrument of a member country owned by the ECB would constitute impermissible financing. Again, the theologians live in Frankfurt. Buying the debt instrument was not financing the country, but restructuring it is financing the country. How those two things coexist, I have not a clue. And we must all await. But also, I think this was an ECB response to pressure from Germany. Germany is deeply skeptical about OMT. They see in it a circumvention on the rules that prohibit financial transfers from one country to another. And as a sop to that sentiment, ECB has said, no, we're not going to do this just by transferring these countries. Have got to adopt an adjustment program which gives us a reasonable basis to believe that indeed they will grow out of this crisis and will never lose one euro on the money that we are lending.
I'm Gonzalo Dias, I teach here at the Catholic Law School. I have also two questions. First, on the OMT, isn't it an action of an incipient form of action of a central bank as a lender of last resort, as it should in any federal system or monetary union? So isn't it a first step towards that action that is claimed by some economists and politicians in Europe? And the second question, like your comment on the European Stability Mechanism and the possibility provided in the treaty of intervening in the primary market rather than in the secondary market as the OMT. There we have a possibility of intervening in the primary market and of course the limitations in the treaty and according to the interpretation of the German Constitutional Court.
Both excellent questions. Yes, you could view OMT as a step in the direction of fiscal union, if you wish. The theory that underlies ECB's assertion of its right to run this program, which some see as a circumvention of the rules against fiscal transfers, the theory is that ECB sets the monetary policy for the whole of Europe. And the ECB says, we scan the horizon, and we see that in certain countries, the markets seem blind to our monetary policy. They are extracting interest rates higher than what they should, and we We believe those higher interest rates are attributable to a fear of a Eurozone breakup, to a redenomination of the debt in other currencies, and therefore, they say, under our mandate to regulate the monetary policy in the whole of the Eurozone, we are going to intervene in those countries where we see these aberrational patterns develop. And that is perfectly consistent, they say, to use the phrase that is often repeated, this is a matter of an interference with the transmission of monetary policy. I'm really not going to address that argument, although it always, having said that, of course I'll do it, it always seemed to me like someone like the theater manager who says, well, I regulate the air conditioning in this theater, and I must ratchet it up because some poor devil out there has the flu, and I see that the transmission of my air conditioning policy is not getting through to him. He's got a fever, so I have to raise it. Anyway, it could be seen that way, and many would applaud. Many would say that inevitably what must come out of this crisis is a closer fiscal union. Countries will begrudgingly surrender their fiscal sovereignty to Brussels, but they need a swift kick in the posterior in order to do that. Yes, you're right about the ESM, European Stability Mechanism. In parallel with the OMT program, remember, which will focus on secondary markets, the European Stability Mechanism, the ESM, has the legal authority to buy in the primary markets. So they can go into the auctions of debt and buy, and that, here's the theory, that demand will keep the interest rate low. And by the way, perhaps the old style bailout, the type that you folks have, the type that Greece had in the beginning, where the Europeans and the IMF lend you the money pursuant to a loan agreement and you repay it back to your existing creditors, maybe that's obsolete. Maybe going forward, the way the bailout will be structured is the ESM will come in and buy in the primary market so that people can say this country continues to have access to the markets. Now, it is, of course, a Potemkin village of access to the markets because a substantial portion of the demand is originating from the official sector, but nonetheless, it will allow people to continue to say that market access has been preserved. Draghi has said once or twice that, in fact, he would see OMT and ESM primary market purchases operating in tandem, and that between the two of them, they would keep the interest rates at a tolerably low level. Again, the question will be, and I don't wish to prejudge it because I don't know it any more than you folks do, this will work for a while, to be sure. The risk is that the problem turns out to be a much longer duration than any of us hope it will. And if ESM and OMT are continuing to buy the debt of the afflicted countries in 5 years, in 7 years, in 10 years, I don't think that will be politically palatable either to the citizenry of the debtor countries or, for that matter, to much of Northern Europe.
Just a quick question. I don't need the micro. My question was in the direction of this last one, but nevertheless, I'll just put another one, a more teasing question, shall we say. If I don't think you believe really, honestly, on the OMT OMT program. And I think also there's a big risk on that if you put Italy, France, or Spain, Greece in the same basket. There will be a problem, I think, with the OMT program. So, if you run out of OMT program, we'll be led to, maybe, to the reprofiling option. But the reprofiling option, isn't it an air cut in the near future? I would like to have a comment on that.
Okay, sure. Am I skeptical? Yes, I'm skeptical. But the beauty of reprofiling is this, and it's the same as in the 1980s. First, you hold the existing creditors in place. If this crisis resolves itself and evaporates like a mist on a chilly hillside, then all is well, and the market effortlessly return to lending. If it doesn't, then some form of more severe debt restructuring is going to be required. Not necessarily in the near future, because after all, the mandatory extension will get all the maturities out, let's say for 5 years. I've even heard up to 7 years. So the country need not go to the market for 5 years. Everyone's been kicked down the road. If in 5 or 7 years the crisis hasn't resolved itself and a restructuring is necessary, two things will be different. One is the holders of the debt will continue to be commercial creditors, and the axe will fall on the neck of commercial parties who lent the money, took the risk, asked for an interest rate commensurate with their view of the risk, and when the risk materialized, they will bear the consequences of it, as opposed to the taxpayers. And second, during that period, let's call it 5 years, the current holders of the debt, Northern European commercial banks in particular, will either have an opportunity to dispose of it in an orderly way, or, as happened in the 1980s, will have the time in which to provision their loan loss reserves against a possible write-down. You see that what happened in the 1980s was between 1982 and 1990, when Mr. Brady came along, while the banks were being told that they didn't have to write down their sovereign portfolios, the regulators were whispering in their ears, you better provision yourself against this. As the Americans say, put something aside for a rainy day. And it was Mr. Brady who came along in 1989 and said, it's raining. But they had 7 years in which to cushion themselves against a potential loss. So the reprofiling would do both of those things. And therefore, to my opinion, and the immediate net present value loss would be muted. To my mind, that makes it the most attractive option if OMT does not succeed. I entirely agree with you. If Mr. Draghi's got to open the throttle on OMT for countries like Spain, Italy, La Belle France, you've got to buy a lot of bonds to move 10 basis points on those yields.
The Germans right now are encouraging Mr. Draghi to force and indicators very famous independent veterans play. And this comparison is done by the president of the Bundesbank, Mr. Jens Wiedmann. So we are no longer talking only about austerity fatigue, but also about bailout fatigue in the Nordic countries. And given the very sizable headwinds we are going to face, what's your view about what's going to happen next, given that the chances of the guarantee are pretty slim, and as you say in your paper, the for reprofiling to be successful, well, maybe we have crossed the Rubicon on that. And secondly, again about the banks, what we are watching right now, unfortunately, is a continuation with some people in the markets call the doom loop, because the domestic banks are lending each time more and more money. We have a very symbiotic relation with a sovereign, and when times get rough, as we see, as we saw in Greece, the financial system is basically at the mercy of the ECB. And another spillover that we got was Cyprus. Cyprus is now undergoing talks to get a bailout from the Troika because they had massive losses with the debt structure in Greece.
Thank you. Excellent questions, all of them. Let me take them in the order in which you raised them. Yes, ESM will have, as currently constituted, limited firepower, large firepower, 500 billion euros, but nonetheless finite. 500 billion euros sounds like a lot of money to you and me, but if they were to have to use it to deal with a debt stock of 2 trillion in Italy, it could quickly run out. The question of foreign creditors running to the hills, to use your phrase, it's very interesting. It goes back to Yanyu's point about the treatment of OMT and ESM, which in the preamble to the ESM treaty claims for itself a seniority over all other creditors. The issue is this, and of course it was played out dramatically, palpably in Greece. Every bond bought by a creditor that claims for itself senior treatment means that in the event of a future debt restructuring, the debt relief must be concentrated on those poor devils who are left. And therefore, if you were a buyer of the bonds of that country, you would actually see these programs as dangerous, because every bond that they buy arguably increases the risk that you will have to bear in more difficult debt restructuring when the time comes. Moreover, and I see things usually from the debtor country's perspective, it is surely a mixed blessing, because if you come to me as the Minister of Finance and say, good news, Minister, the ECB and the ESM are going to buy large quantities of your debt, I know that if in the future I have got to restructure, I've now got a huge slug of my debt stock that is hors de combat, that is outside of my ability to restructure it, and that is a frightening thing to me, that if I need to slap around, I can and will slap around. You make the point quite correctly that the OMT was not universally popular. Mario Draghi in his press conference had a wonderful phrase. He said, I want to assure everyone that OMT was unanimously supported by the board, except for those who voted against it. There was one prominent vote against it, namely his largest shareholder. They clearly have misgivings. Draghi went this week, I believe, to Berlin in order to try to assuage some of those concerns. I think, at least in the immediate instance, he's done so. But again, if this thing drags on and he buys more and more, this is an institution that has a paid-in capital of 10 billion euros. Had they marked to market their Greek exposure, it would have bankrupted them 2.5 times over, just that one trivial little country. As for the doom loop, to use your phrase, let's be candid, friends. The reason that we're in this mess is that as countries entered the Eurozone and adopted the common currency, the markets believed that a monetary union was tantamount to a fiscal union. If you see the graph, I should have brought it, it is dramatic, it is breathtaking. It will show you as a country enters the Eurozone, the spreads, the difference between its borrowing costs and those of Germany converge very quickly, to the point that very soon after entering the Eurozone in 2001, Greek yields were only 20 basis points, or 1/5 of 1%, higher than those of Germany. Now that would suggest to you that the markets believed that the inherent creditworthiness of Greece was equivalent to that of Germany. it pleased no one in the official sector all those years to have stood up and said, are you mad? What are you, the markets, doing? Do you really believe that Greece is as creditworthy as Germany? Why should you be prepared to lend to Greece at the same level? Compounded by the fact that bank regulation allowed a bank in the Eurozone to buy a bond of a Eurozone sovereign and put it on its books with no capital charge, whatever, it was risk-free, whether it was Germany or Greece or Cyprus, it was risk-free as far as the bank regulators were concerned. Moreover, they could buy a bond of Slovenia, take it to the ECB discount window and get the same discount they could from a German bond. So the markets were, they may have been foolish, but they were surely not reprimanded for their foolishness during all that period. The result was that, yes indeed, regulated financial institutions bought sovereign bonds, particularly of their host governments. The governments loved it because that was demanded, allowed them to issue at a lower coupon. But it created this noxious intertwining of the fate of the banking sector and the sovereign that we see again and again and again. You cannot restructure the sovereign without decimating the banking sector. Many would say that was the heart of this problem. It's worse than that. You take it from me. If a politician can borrow unlimited quantities of money dirt cheap, that politician will borrow unlimited quantities of money dirt cheap. Politicians are a pillar of jello. If they have access to money, look, what are the choices? If you're running a budget deficit, you may increase your taxes. No politician will do that voluntarily. You may cut your expenditures. No politician will do that voluntarily. But if someone is there saying, I'll lend to you cheap, I'll lend you at the same rate as Germany, you will borrow to cover the budget deficits. Not just in an emergency, not just because you've gone to war with Ruritania, but because the budget deficits are chronic, you will borrow and borrow and borrow and borrow. And that's how the debt stocks got to be what they are. In a healthy, functioning financial market, the market itself exerts the control over the sovereign debtor. If the market feels that they're getting beyond their reasonable debt servicing capacity, the first thing that happens is the coupons go up on the debt. If the market becomes too frightened, the market turns arthritic and will not lend at all. But the moment that the markets are persuaded that the Eurozone and monetary union was in fact a fiscal union, that the credit worthiness of every member was homogenous, had been homogenized, they were prepared to lend far more than they would normally have done exercising normal market prudence. So it interfered with that mechanism, allowing the politicians to borrow to the point that their debt stocks became insupportably high. I'm sorry to say it, but that is, I think, what happened.
I agree, and therefore I would like to ask you, if Greece took us here, how do you see the survival of Europe? Because I see it very, very critical.
I'm sorry.
I was saying that Greece took us to this point of.
You want to wait for the microphone?
She'll bring you a microphone.
I was just saying that I agree with your analysis, and if Greece took us here, both from politicians and also from the market, not only because of possible rates for owners and for complying with their objectives every year, so we got here because of Greece. So it's difficult to see how we are going to get out of this, especially because there's no miraculous way of getting out of this. So as an outsider and someone from the other side of the planet, do you see any possibility of the euro surviving this?
I think the euro will survive.
You are an optimist.
this is a magnificent experiment, and the euro has brought enormous prosperity to the eurozone. I think it will survive. I think there is a reasonable chance that there will be greater fiscal union. I think the euro would survive even if a single member were to leave. I'm not a believer that Greece leaving the euro would collapse the entire experiment. I really don't think the markets view it that way. So my own guess is the euro does survive, but this crisis will result in profound changes to how the eurozone regulates itself.
Hi, this is this is Henry Almeida from Bloomberg News. I just have a question, specific question about Portugal. And the question is, Portugal has been given more time to meet its budget deficit targets, but it had to increase taxes to a point that some economists say will be unbearable. They cite the latter curve, that after taxes reach a certain point, they become counterproductive. It might be the question of the whole adjustment program, further weighing on the economy, which is already in a recession. Bond markets have so far been good to Portugal, in the sense that yields have fallen in all maturities. But that's above the surface. Under the surface, there seems to be the skepticism about Portugal's adjustment program. Do you think that Portugal is moving closer to a Greek scenario or to an Irish success story scenario? And the second question is, if you were advising Portugal's prime minister on how to succeed in his adjustment program, what would you tell him?
I think I would put Portugal closer to the success story. I think you entered this crisis with fundamentals that were much better than a country like Greece. Your adjustment program has been rigorous. There has been, at least until the last couple of months, a surprising acceptance of that adjustment program by the Portuguese citizenry. Our European friends are desperate to have a success story. Therefore, they will continue to grant you a relaxation of the program, if necessary, going forward, because they want this effort to succeed. If it fails, then their entire policies for the last several years will be viewed by historians as severely misguided. The bond yields have declined, I think less because of a sea change in the perception of the fundamentals in Portugal, but I think they have declined because people see OMT on the horizon and they are looking forward to the put back to Mr. Draghi. It has the merits and demerits that we discussed a moment ago. What would I tell the Prime Minister at this stage, as far into it as you are, I would carry on. The great question mark will be your next maturity that is not funded by your bailout program comes due in 11 months in September of next year. The hope is that you will be able to return to voluntary markets at a tolerably low interest level for that. My guess is that the Prime Minister is saying to himself, if the deus ex machina of Mr. Draghi appears, he will ensure that I can refinance next September at a low interest rate. And if he doesn't, the European needs to have a success story will mean that they'll extend the program. I'm not saying that does not have political consequences to it. It will. It will surely have political consequences, but that might be his view. I'm going to be cynical again for a moment. he might say to himself, look, the debt stock is moving very fast into the hands of the official sector. I've got the numbers here. It's quite dramatic. If you project it out to 2014, most of the debt stock will have migrated into the hands of the official sector. If this problem continues and does not resolve itself, and if some form of a formal debt restructuring, reprofiling, whatever it is required, he's got to negotiate that at a political level. He doesn't have to sit with a bunch of tiresome, disgruntled bondholders. He's got to go to Brussels and Berlin and Washington, D.C. and negotiate that restructuring. So he might just say to himself, look, let's carry on with this. No one knows the future. We all hope it will resolve itself. But if it doesn't, that doesn't mean that there isn't some remedy down the road that I can pursue, and maybe that remedy will be easier than having to do a debt restructuring, inflict this pain on my own citizens, because Portuguese debt is predominantly held by Portuguese institutions. Why should I inflict the pain on them if someone's prepared to pay them out in full? Why not wait for the day when I restructure it with the official sector, and that poor Hausfrau in Stuttgart who pays her taxes, she's the one who takes the spear at that point.
My name is Pedro Candice, I'm a practicing lawyer in Lisbon. Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation, making very difficult topics look simple. You clearly passed the idea that you favor reprofiling. I have a three-folded question on reprofiling. First, with the benefit of hindsight, looking back at the Greek habit, do you think that reprofiling would have been the solution, even though we would still be halfway through the period, typical period of reprofiling? Second question. Guessing that reprofiling was not particularly favored by commercial banks, maybe because of the acts that you mentioned in the guillotine illustration, and acknowledging that commercial banks are a reality, they will always have a say in any restructure or in any plan. How do you see the future of reprofiling? Because I think the future will still have commercial banks having a say and having an influence in it. So it's just twofold.
Okay, good questions. I'll answer them in the order that you've asked them. With the benefit of hindsight, might reprofiling have been preferable back in May of 2010 for Greece? I would say yes. Again, my basic analysis is this. A reprofiling does not reduce the debt stock, by definition. It just kicks it down the road. But it kicks it down the road in such a way that either the crisis ends on its own and the debt stock is supportable, or you've got to do a more severe debt restructuring when that mandatory extension ends. If you have to do the latter, the whole debt stock remains intact in the hands of private creditors to get the debt relief that you need, commonsensically. The terms that you must inflict on any one of those creditors is diluted by the fact that they exist in a very large creditor universe. The risk that they took with Greece in May of 2010 was the more of the debt stock that migrated in the hands of official sector creditors, if a restructuring became necessary, which we now know that it did, the terms of that restructuring had to be as savage as what was required. Left entirely to my own devices, I would have followed the pattern of the 1980s. I would not have had taxpayers repay existing creditors. I would not have forced them to take a principal loss or anything like that. Your second question, you're right. Banks, who are the principal holders of this debt, have a voice in what is being done. They are not fans of reprofiling. Let me share with you a priceless jewel of wisdom. They are not fans of any form of debt restructuring. Ask your average bank owner of a bond, which would you prefer, that I restructure you or that the taxpayers pay you out in full and on time? He'll think a long time about it. And he'll come to one of those two conclusions. Here, by the way, is the sovereign debt restructurer's response to a bank who says, I don't want to reprofile. It goes like this. I'll give you two options, sir. Option one, you reprofile and take the risk that 5 years from now, I may have to inflict real pain upon you in the form of debt. Option two is, I inflict the pain right now. So which would you prefer, take a chance to defer it for 5 years, or would you rather have me do it right now? Because I'm ready, willing, and able to do it. That's the beauty of these debt stocks. With the local law, a debt restructurer has weapons that we have never had in any other situation.
Good evening. My name is Alfonso. I'm a student from the first year in Catholic in law. I have two questions for you. One is regarding the housing bubble in the United States, which as we know began in 2008 and is the major responsible for the current world crisis. What has since the crisis began in the United States? What has the United States been doing differently from Europe that has given them an upper hand regarding their economic health? And Iceland, a country in which 2008 or 2009 received the biggest bailout in history, is presently demonstrating a bigger economic growth than most countries combined. Since they did this, since they're gaining this economic growth, after refusing to pay back the banks that put them in that same situation, what has stopped other countries from doing the same?
Again, excellent questions. I'll take them in the order that you asked them. What has the U.S. been doing differently from Europe? I think the U.S. has been lucky thus far. There is a school of thought which says that the U.S. economy, confronted with its own fiscal problems, is in a far more fragile situation than the markets, at least the equity markets, appear to be viewing it right now. The U.S., remember, has one inestimable advantage over the Europeans. The United States borrows only in its own currency, which means that confronted with an insupportably large debt stock, which some would say we are quickly approaching, the U.S. has an escape valve that you folks don't. We can inflate our way out of it if we need to. Understand, inflation is just another way of defaulting, but it is a far less politically visible way of defaulting. But there never need to come a time when the United States would need to default or would need to restructure its debt if it is prepared to endure inflation with all the ravages that come with that on a society. That can be the escape. There are those who would say that we are doing it even today. Our interest rates are near zero. Our inflation rate, 2.5-3%. So negative real interest rates of 2.5-3%. Well, 3 to 4 years, and your debt stock in terms of real value has been reduced by 10%, simply by that degree of inflation. If inflation were to take off to a higher level, which it hasn't to date, I acknowledge, but if it were to do so in the future, that is something that could happen. I won't speculate, it's somewhat beyond the topic this evening, as to why investors continue to buy US government bonds. I think, frankly, at this point, it comes down to this: how many New Zealand dollars can you own? As the French say, for want of better and for fear of worse, people buy US government bonds, although they are obviously a profligate fiscal nation. Iceland, I should say, by way of disclosure, I represented Iceland in its dispute with the United Kingdom and the Netherlands on the so-called ice sale situation. What happened in Iceland, remember, Iceland was really the first. We keep talking about Greece as the first, but really it was Iceland. Iceland, a nation of 322,000 people, they had essentially abdicated responsibility for regulating their financial system. Their banks ran wild, they ran up liabilities of 10 times gross domestic product. When the crisis hit Iceland, it was perfectly apparent that for Iceland to have stepped in and said, we're going to take over the liabilities of the banks as the Irish, not so long thereafter, would have saddled those 322,000 dismal souls with a liability, a gargantuan liability. So Iceland said, we're not going to do that. You folks lent to commercial banks. We regret to tell you those commercial banks are insolvent. And I'm sorry, you're going to lose your money. The result was that Iceland has, in a relatively short space of time, really made remarkable progress in returning to a growth path. They actually issued a bond, I think, earlier this year in the markets at a reasonable interest rate, I think 5%. They could not have done that had they taken on the liabilities that their banks had incurred. Our Irish friends, I'm afraid, took a different path. And the Irish, as you will recall, slapped a government guarantee on their bank liabilities, to be sure. The finance minister at the time, Mr. Lenihan, did not really have any idea just how deep the hole was in those banks. He had been advised that it was acceptably small. It turned out to be massively larger. But they slapped a guarantee around it, and therefore the debt to GDP of this of the Irish Republic went from something like 14% to 70 or 80% overnight. And it is in part the cause of Ireland's difficulties right now.
I think we'll have the last question.
Hi, my name is Miguel Magrado, and I'm a professor here at the university. I just wanted to give a little piece of information regarding something you mentioned a little while ago. You said that Portugal is facing this big bond payment in September next year, 2014. Actually, at the beginning of this month, the Portuguese government was able to put a debt exchange offer. So 39% of that amount was actually related to 2015. So I would say that the Portuguese government is only facing an equivalent hurdle as regards bond payments in June 2014. So we have, as it were, an extra year on that.
Yes, I do know that. I think the amount that was extended was 3.75 billion out of a total of 900 something billion. Step back from it, and what the Portuguese government did was reprofile. Thank you very much for that question.